perched high above the blacktop. It seems almost unreal. Impossibly far. And yet, just beyond reach. The desires that it instills are basic. Power, freedom, and conquest. The dream that it inspires is of shedding all earthbound limitations. And it beckons to all who dare mount their assault. For those who aspire to rule the skies, taking flight is only the beginning.
It's all about having supreme confidence, and not many guys have it.
You own the ball, you own the game, you own the guy who's guarding you, and you can actually play him like a puppet.
One bounce dribble out of Jordan. Michael hit from the left side, jammed it right.
You don't last in this league long by being timid or intimidated by the people you compete against.
Get tough, X. Get tough. Don't let him push you.
McDaniel with a facial.
Saying move over, buddy. You know, it's two of us here.
Ray rocked the baby to sleep and slam dunk.
Just like Tyson, when he walk in the rain, he walk in the rain to take you out.
These are people who can really just actually dunk on you, just don't care about you, your well-being. They will dunk in your face and just make you like it.
NBA Entertainment presents the Super Slams of the NBA. The spectacle, the sensation, the exhilaration that knows no boundaries. The aspirations of leaving the earth behind, but only a select few can experience the unrestrained freedom of flight.
People ask me, you really think you can fly? I say, yeah, for a little while.
Come on, Jordan, fly. Here he goes! Get him!
For his fans and his peers alike, Jordan is a natural wonder to behold, as he defies reason and gravity.
Once you get up there, then you say, well, maybe I just hang up here for a while, you know, up in the air and just sit back. And then all of a sudden, well, maybe I 360, no, I changed my mind, maybe I go up on there on the other side. And he's just incredible.
When fellow hang glider Clyde Drexler takes to the air, he too conjures up images of flight and of grace that transcends sport.
The start of it is wonderful. The acceleration, the drive to get to the basket, and the actual slam dunk is beautiful. That's why I consider Michael Jordan, Clyde Drexler, the most graceful basketball players that play the ball game today.
Ballet and basketball, I think, are very close. I think basketball is a form of ballet. So you go right down the line from team to team, the guys that have the leaping ability, are usually the guys that will have the most similarity to the dancers.
And perhaps basketball's most elegant performer best captures its essence.
My reaction and my internal reaction was more of calm and peace after the accomplishment. It's interesting how much that's turned around now, because now, you know, we see guys dunk the ball. I mean, they get really excited and hype about it, start jumping up and down, raising fists.
What really get me psyched up is a dunk. That, you know, to me, you know, that can get me psyched up, get me going.
The thing that excites me the most is when a coach call a timeout and chew his forward out, because I just dunked on his head.
But the mailman is not alone in delivering punishing jams.
Charles want to. He can do whatever he want to out there. There's very few guys can take over a game in the league, and he's probably one of them.
Charles looks like he's just determined to take over this game. Here's Dominic. Here's Dominic.
Oh! It's a good feeling. It's a strong, powerful feeling. You can dunk on a big guy, and you know he's going at your shot hard.
Dominic.
I think in my neighborhood, it was a physical thing. I think only the strong survived.
Buckle up, slam dunk by McDaniel.
All right, Ewing.
I try to dunk it as hard as possible, so the next time I go to dunk it, the person who's checking me or anybody else, they'll think first before they'll try to block it.
They are the explosive dunkers of the NBA. And they generate contagious excitement.
Out!
They've dropped off now.
Out! Out! Dare you!
Stole it, McKee. Oh! 2-on-1. Harper to the end. He drives. Wham! With the right hand. School's out. Here I come.
But all demolition dunkers must pay final homage to the man they call Chocolate Thunder.
Damn, I did that. I broke a backbone.
You looked around like, you believe what he just did? He just tore that thing. The glass was just flying everywhere.
Now, I gotta see if I can do this again.
To Doug Collins, to Darryl Dawkins. Oh, he did it again. He broke it again. He's broken another backboard. That's twice in one season. And the crowd goes nuts. Oh, my.
Doug Collins comes down with the ball. I'm pretty sure it was Doug Collins. Bobby Jones cut through. He dished it off to me. And I went up, put it back on the numbers, and came through one more time. And it came down. Glass started falling, I started saying, yeah, dig it, yeah. But the commissioner stopped there real quick.
Claiming to hail from the planet Lovetron, Dawkins often seemed to be the NBA's version of extraterrestrial life.
Are you with me, Laura?
As an 18-year-old rookie, he would gain instant notoriety for his outrageous dunks and even more outrageous names for them.
So I get up one night and I dunk a good one. The backboard's still shaking. I'm like halfway back down the board. I look back down and still swinging. And people are like, they say, what was that? I say, get out of the way and backboard swing, game delaying. If you ain't grooving, you best get moving. They said, what? So I say, hey, I'm getting a good response from this. I think I'll name them all. I had a turbo sexophonic delight dunk where I went up and swiveled the hips a little bit and kind of brought it across.
Here's Dawkins posting on Donaldson. Look out!
I had the rump roasted bun toast and cake shaking, baby making, thank you, well, ma'am, I am jam dunk.
Here's Dawkins. Oh, what a muscle move! And this time it's against Philadelphia.
and I had to dunk call your mama. And that was for anybody who jumped in front of me while I was trying to dunk it. I'll just throw it right in on them and say, your mama.
After 14 years as the NBA's clown prince of dunk, Dawkins would take his celebrated act across the ocean to Italy, where he received an enthusiastic reception from his new hometown fans. Quickly captivating his new audience, Dawkins didn't take long to realize the benefits of becoming an international entertainer. Though Darryl may be plying his trade overseas, the domestic dunk craze continues as even the most unlikely participants seem eager to get into the act. Though some may attempt more death-defying feats than others, the results are always entertaining. Footlocker Slam Fest, athletes from other sports got the chance to showcase their high wire acts. From Neon Deion Sanders,
hold on, folks, buckle up,
to triple jumper Mike Conley, they all had their moment in the dunking spotlight. Midsummer Night's Classic made it clear that even during the off-season, the NBA's Air Force rules the skies.
All right, now we ready, now we ready.
Today, the dunking rage leaves no one untouched. But in basketball's formative years, the NBA's greatest players, like George Mikan of the Minneapolis Lakers and Bob Pettit of the St. Louis Hawks, shunned the stuff shot for fear of repercussions from their rough and tumble opponents.
I mean, I could dunk, but I would never even think of doing it. You never saw anybody take off from the foul line and try to dunk. You did that, somebody would just put you right in the third row.
In those rugged early years, an attempted dunk was a sign of disrespect, and it would be met with the swiftest of punishments.
Well, every time you left your feet, you were endangering yourself because they'd take your legs right out. Players certainly could dunk the ball, but if you dunked a ball, your man didn't like it, and you would pay for it the next time.
But despite this shot's perilous nature, the indomitable Minneapolis Lakers still dare to practice this rather unique way of putting the ball in the basket.
We had guys that could dunk it just as well, but maybe not as high now. When we would warm up, we would have guys like Pollard and Mickelson and myself and a whole bunch all go up and dunk the ball.
Slowly gaining acceptance, the dunk made its way from the practice court to primetime action. But this was only the beginning. For in the collegiate ranks, fans were flocking to arenas to catch a glimpse of a dunking prodigy by the name of Wilt Chamberlain.
When I was in junior high school, no one ever seen one dunk a basketball. And I started just throwing balls down through the basket, and that was a whole new thing.
Upon entering the league in 1959, this brazen rookie not only ushered the slam into prominence, but also utilized it as a devastating offensive weapon that could not help but command attention.
The best dunk I ever saw was when Chamberlain would go up there and dunk that ball. That was sensational, because Chamberlain would slam it, really slam it down with tremendous force.
Like Chamberlain, Baltimore's bruising forward, Gus Johnson, was another dynamic dunking force whose overwhelming physical skills astonished the opposition.
Gus was probably the most spectacular dunker during my era, because he could dunk from 5 or 6 feet away from the basket, going by the basket.
A power slammer with an imposing presence, Johnson attacked the basket with a reckless abandon, and very few dared stand in his way. In contrast, high-flying Laker legend Elgin Baylor made his way to the basket less with force than finesse. While Baylor's contemporary, fluid performer Connie Hawkins also captured the imagination by bringing a stylish grace to the art form.
To me, it was a form of expression. And a lot of times you can be playing and come up with a dunk that could turn the momentum around in the game. That was important.
Connie was the ultimate finesse. He was the first that I had ever seen with the huge hands that could glide and dunk and stuff all kind of different ways.
Leaving his personal mark on dunking artistry, Hawkins astounded the basketball world with his distinct flair for the game. But though the art of dunking had begun to flourish, the NBA mainstream was still dominated by the traditional. With the perennial champion Boston Celtics setting a conservative tone, some of basketball's more daring innovators began to look elsewhere to find an outlet for their creative energies. The Offbeat American Basketball Association would provide an enticing alternative as these basketball mavericks thrived in this free-spirited new league.
The ABA was a run-and-gun league. You had guys who liked to run, who liked to get out, and you know, they got a chance to just go to the hoop and invented different ways to throw the ball down.
The pace was fast and furious as new-look dunkers filled the airwaves.
One of the challenges of the league, the ABA, was not to follow, you know, the precedent that had been established with the NBA, not just be a carbon copy of the NBA, be something different.
The ABA had found acceptance from its more established predecessor, due in large part to its larger-than-life symbol, Julius Erving. Quickly demonstrating his pioneering style, Dr. J made frequent and memorable house calls to the opposition's basket.
I felt if I got near the basket that I could score at anybody. And the first way was to try and score over. If that lane opens up, you go in there and, you know, you ram the ball.
Irving's supremacy would be tested in 1976 when the acrobatic David Thompson vied for slam dunk preeminence in professional basketball's first dunk contest. Both men would leave the audience breathless, but in dramatic fashion, the good doctor would have the final word.
It was really a showcase for the league. It probably still, from an emotional standpoint, was the best one that there's ever been.
When the ADA was absorbed by the NBA, Dr. J faced yet another challenge.
The pressures on a Julius Erving and the impact he had on the NBA. Who is this Dr. J who wins these dunk contests and does all of these things?
Joining the Philadelphia 76ers, Irving wasted no time in making his impact felt as he boldly announced his arrival, making the NBA Finals in his first year and doing it his way.
95% of the things that I did on the basketball court, I had done before. I really considered those routine plays, although I knew they were beyond the boundaries that one would call fundamental. I mean, it was not a risky shot for me to go and dunk the ball backwards.
Immediately attracting a devoted following, Irving was embraced by even the worthiest of opponents.
See, I didn't want him to make me look so bad, so when he dunked it, I'd catch him in the air. You know, for everybody can, like, say, ooh, he's a nice guy, not letting Doc drop.
Bringing the art of slam dunking to new heights, Irving was now the game's most recognizable figure.
When you went on this road with Julius, it was like traveling with a rock star. If Dr. J got to the open court and dunked a basketball, it didn't matter what the score was. Everybody in the stands felt that they got their money's worth. They saw the doctor.
After an 8-year hiatus, Gatorade would resurrect the slam dunk contest in Denver. And once again, Dr. J was the main attraction.
76ers, Julius the Doctor.
Competing against the hungry young legion of dunkers, this living legend would perform with typical brilliance. And although Larry Nance would defeat him in the finals, Irving had inspired a new generation of aerial assaulters to whom he would now pass the torch of dunking mastery.
I think it elevates any team when you have a guy who's exciting, he dunks it, gets the crowd going, gets your teammates going, get the coach going. It's, I think, an inspirational type of move.
When he exploded onto the scene in 1982, Dominique Wilkins was aptly nicknamed the human highlight film. And in playing to rave reviews, Atlanta's spectacular forward had the league's full attention, but Neek was not alone.
Davis. To Warren. He may put the move on.
It's like ecstasy almost. I mean, when I see an opening to the basket, they say my eyes get really big. But I'm gonna tell you something that's kind of ironic. People ask me, well, do you know what you're gonna do before you get to the basket? I never know. It's a rhythm thing. Steve
Johnson. And this feeling of spontaneity was shared by others.
My body be in a lot of different ways when I be in the air, and I never know how I'm gonna land or how I'm gonna go up, but it just always had worked out good for me.
And though the dunk was still a free-flowing art form, it was now also a disarming psychological weapon.
Dunking is such an overpowering way to score a basket. People can see a dunk, and that dunk would almost, although it only means 2 points, but it always seemed to be 6 points.
Even as a rookie, Jordan's immense talent was apparent to all as he dazzled audiences and confounded his opponents with a vast array of show-stopping dunks.
Back to Jordan. Oh! Jordan with a super move.
It's like a big juice of energy, like somebody pushed your electricity button, and it gives you a lift, and it takes some away from nothing.
Also taking the NBA by storm in the mid-80s was Philadelphia's one-man wrecking crew, Charles Barkley. Terrorizing the opposition en route to the basket, Barkley, too, sent a message with every thunderous jab.
It's just a question of coming through. You know what you can do, just go out and do it. Let it flow.
A graduate of the University of Houston's Phi Slamma Jamma dunking fraternity, Drexler easily made the transition to the pros, using his full repertoire of slams as his personal calling card. Infusing arenas with a contagious electricity, this majestic group of aerial voyagers left their indelible mark on the evolution of the dunk and motivated their peers to do the same.
Dominique from the outside. No. Oh.
But when it came time to bring contest-style dunks into game action, few could match the mid-air exploits of Dominique Wilkins. But there are times when the virtuoso performances of players like Wilkins are only a part of a larger artistic collaboration.
Jackson with the ball.
When I hit the floor, I try to create for my other teammates. And I love to throw the alley-oop pass, and that's the most exciting play to me.
Considered by many to be basketball's most captivating connection, the alley-oop is perhaps the game's most compelling evidence that an unspoken language between players does exist.
We don't really have to communicate verbally on the court. We're able to just read each other naturally, and I think that's the exciting thing about it.
And when it comes to communicating on a higher plane, nobody astounds his audience quite like Magic Johnson.
You definitely come to give them a show, if at all possible, while you're playing.
While the magic show keeps you guessing, the finale never ceases to amaze.
Rebound to Michael Cooper. The magic. Magic underneath right side of the goal.
For when Magic does hook up with his high-flying cohort, the results are pure entertainment.
That's an entertainment, or showmanship, if you want to say it, of two people who has tremendous creativity, and you never know exactly what's going to happen next.
Jordan is a showman of a different kind, one who finishes brilliantly on the receiving end. But he is also equally adept at returning the favor, displaying an unselfishness that is the essence of teamwork.
Sally, oh, what a play! What a play! Right into the arms of Cheeks. Doc crumbles inside to Barkley. What a show! What a show!
For both the fans who watch it unfold and the players who execute to perfection, the fast break is a vivid illustration of team harmony.
I definitely get most thrill out of a perfectly run fast break. If we have guys fill in the lanes and somebody finishes off the play with authority, I think that's the most exciting for me.
And fittingly, this hard-driving style of play is often punctuated by a dunk.
for Elo. Stopped by Walker. A two-handed rejection. Nice touch pass from Oakley.
The NBA's devastating dunkers make putting the ball through the hoop look easy. But ever so quickly, the thin line between the dazzling and the dreadful can be crossed. And the most basic skills can turn into an exercise in humiliation. Not even the NBA's most imposing Goliaths are immune to the ultimate embarrassment of the missed dunk. It happens often.
Robinson, he missed the slam.
And even though it defies description, it is still open for explanation.
Once you zero in on a basket, you know you're trying to let anything distract you.
Good pass. Harris missed the dunk. Charles Oakley dishes to Ewing inside. Missed the game.
A lot of it is just, you know, natural ability.
It may be amusing, but it's certainly not part of a coach's winning formula.
Slam dunk and he threw it.
And yet the muff stuff is an everyday part of the game that can't help but be taken lightly.
I mean, you know, that's the fun about being a pro sometimes.
But sometimes NBA big men seem to need a lesson in the finer points of dunking. And their smaller counterparts are happy to oblige.
Oh, he's got it again.
Optimal finish.
Bud gets it back.
I think it's a good weapon for me. Athletes are bigger and better. So I try to use it as a good weapon in the open floor when I get to the basket.
All-star Kevin Johnson utilizes the slam as a form of expression.
This is a way that I can go out and express myself in an artistic manner. And I think, and it's very fun and exciting.
Johnson, great step move. Here's Kenny Smith, he's got it all along.
For whether it means dunking into the heart of a defense, racing away from the pack, or just throwing it down for fun, the NBA's diminutive dunkers are now recognized as prime-time jammers.
I try to beat my man, get in traffic, and I'll try to dunk it or score any way I have to. Sometimes I have to be a little creative.
Slamming may be an area of expertise usually reserved for bigger players. But despite their smaller stature, this group of men are giants in their field. And none stand taller than 5'7" Spud Webb.
You have to have a strong mental capacity to put up with a lot of stuff at a smaller size, but if you don't believe in yourself, no one else will.
On one magical afternoon in 1986, Spud would dramatically display that belief in himself as he returned home to Dallas and turned the Gatorade Slam Dunk Contest into his personal showcase. Spud's stunning performance would take a special place in slam dunk history. But he was not the first to bring high drama to its yearly championship. A year earlier, Dominique Wilkins and rookie Michael Jordan had faced off in one of the contest's most spectacular mid-air confrontations. Dominique would emerge victorious. Jordan would have his chance in 1987 as an injured Dominique watched him claim his first slam dunk crown.
And now, here's Jordan ready to take off. straight to the basket, just like he was floating on air. Up in the air. Now he's sideways. Look at the air. Look at the hang time. Look at the flying motion.
Fittingly, Jordan would first defend his title in front of his hometown fans in Chicago, where the stage was finally set for his much-anticipated rematch with Dominique.
Perfect score of 50 on that dunk from Dominique Wilkins.
Well, we're still even as Jordan goes up and takes it way down.
Kenny Walker would step into the slam dunk spotlight in 1989 as he rose from obscurity to add another Cinderella story to the annals of contest history. Skywalker's dramatic victory would pave the way for the emergence of a host of talented young dunk artists.
Crosses to himself for the two-handed reverse jam. Yes, he gets it. This one looks like a good one. Yes!
And though 1990 would see Dominique reclaim the title, a new wave of aerial acrobats would burst onto the slam dunk scene that next year.
Coming in from another angle. Oh, that's big.
Yes.
One hand off the glass.
That's a spectacular dunk.
Here is Lou Edwards.
Get up!
Now, but this legion of high flyers are threatening to rule the skies.
They're gonna have to motivate this stuff to stay with me because I'm kind of the new kid on the block.
Intercepted by Camp. Look out! It was shot! Straight over to Camp. Here he comes! Oh, my!
Making jump barrels.
Dribble drive. Nice little slam dunk. That's a great play.
Rex
can jump. And Chapman jumps in.
Bolts with Chapman on the alley-oop, and that is a career high.
Can't reach him.
Talented new dunkers such as Lou Edwards aspire to take slamming to still greater heights. But no matter how much promise these slam dunk prodigies have shown, they have yet to reach the lofty plateau shared exclusively by two incomparable masters of their craft, the breathtaking Michael Jordan and the sensational Dominique Wilkins, the standard bearers of slam dunk showmanship. They are the proud descendants of the forefather of modern dunking.
Probably a guy that most guys growing up emulated, and that was Julius Erving. I mean, I patterned my whole life after him.
Although Dr. J is regarded as the shot's foremost innovator, he is humble about his contributions.
I'm so far from being the guy who invented the dunk shot that it is kind of amusing. And I generally tell the kids I'm not that old in terms of taking the game above the rim on a consistent basis and making good plays. I can take some of the credit for that. And it did spur a wave of slam dunkers and high flyers.
With his groundbreaking style, Erving not only brought dunking into vogue, but he also provided a glimpse of its spectacular future.
It's really strange, though, you know, because when you always think that, well, here's this one guy, nobody ever be better than that. You had Elgin Baylor, then Julius Erving came along. And then as great as Julius was and all the amazing things he did, there's somebody who's taken it a level above that, a fellow by the name of Michael Jordan.
But Jordan's seemingly boundless ability may find its truest measure in his compelling rivalry with Dominique Wilkins.
It's a fun event. I mean, I enjoy competing against Dominique because he's going to do something that everybody loves to do. That's the dunk. And the dunk is something that inspires everybody. And it certainly inspires me when I'm playing against him.
Oh, you find yourself watching sometime because, you know, you never know what those two guys are going to do.
Ultimately, it is in the air where such spellbinding improvisationalists become legends. And the most storied of slam dunk fables come alive.
My brother Dominique, playing against Milwaukee, they throw the ball to Dominique on the wing, and the whole team collapses on him.
Down low for Dominique. Baseline drive, Dominique. Oh, my goodness! Did you see that jam? I don't know how he did that, Dominique!
Bob Lanier had covered the rim, and I turned sideways, and I turned back around in the air and dunked it on him. That still sticks out in my mind.
I just know, you know, anytime Chicago comes in town, you have to leave your family and everybody else home. You don't want to be embarrassed.
Now the Bulls beat the pressure. Jordan from Vincent. Look out.
And Hollywood went up in there on the fast break, and all of a sudden, Jordan went up about 10 or 12 more notches than I did. You know, you're not ashamed to say you stand there in awe.
I still have vivid memories of a Dr. J tomahawk dunk.
Eaton had stayed back, but here comes Erving anyway.
He went up over the top of me and came crashing down and about took the rim off the backboard and just kind of left me standing there with Spalding across my head.
People don't realize is I played 15 minutes that night and I fouled out. And I was a little bit upset because I thought I was getting some bad calls. And I just needed some way to show my anger out.
Kemp picks Mark Jackson, gets the give and go. Oh!
It was no way that we thought he could dunk the basketball, but proved us all wrong.
Oh, please, let's see that again 100 times.
Well, I think it was one when Chambers went over Mark Jackson. I mean, that was an awesome dunk.
2-on-1, KJ to Chambers, jam! Oh, boy, he went right up Mark Jackson.
When he hit Mark, he was already high. But when he hit Mark, he went a little higher, and he just tore the rim down.
Earlier on, I saw a guy named David Thompson. Somebody on his team took a shot, and the ball bounced so high off the rim. You know, I don't think I'll really be exaggerating when I say the guy went up nose high to the rim.
Oh, David Thompson!
Dominique, it's a tip jam. He comes over about two of his teammates back, and just jump right over one hand, just throws it down through the hoop. I mean, it's just awesome. You see that, you be like, God.
Dominique Wilkins, look out.
I tell you a story that I think summed the whole thing up. We was playing in Chicago in Salt Lake. They switched and put John Stockton on him. And he turned around and dunked on Stockton. So some guy got up and almost followed him down the sideline and said, hey, Jordan, pick on somebody your own size. So next time down the floor, he dunked on Mel Turpin and went over and looked at the guy and said, was he big enough?
Oh, my favorite dunk of all time would probably be the dunk that
Dr. J had over Michael Cooper.
Yes, he's got it. Here he comes. Ray rocked the baby to sleep and slam dunk.
Dr. J just kind of like cuffed it and just glided to the basket. It was the most awesome dunk that I've seen in a basketball game.